It started as a simple dream. Buy an old boat, fix it up, and take it down to Costa Rica for some charter fishing. Admittedly, we had no idea what we were getting into. This was not a unique idea. Hundreds of American captains have followed the same path, and even if it starts out well, they find out that the Costa Rica environment will destroy your boat. Intense sun, salt, and waves, combined with an absence of proper marina facilities, means that after a couple seasons, most boats are ready to get sunk to the bottom. The FishingNosara Build Team was founded with the idea of building boats that would stand the test of time and deliver lifetime memories to our clients. We don't have big money or fancy facilities, just hand tools and passion. The first boat we put in the water is our flagship 32-foot T-Craft, the Wanderer. For the last 8 years, the Wanderer has run more trips than any boat in Central America. After 2 years of great fishing, we found the need to add to the fleet with the 26-foot Super Panga Explorer, perfectly suited for smaller groups who didn't need all the bells and whistles of a 32-foot boat. In 2013, we added the Adventurer, a lightweight, nimble 23-foot panga boat to further ply the craft of extreme panga fishing. Then for the next 2 years, we bit off way more than we can chew in the form of the 32-foot Tower T-Craft Discoverer. The Discoverer was our most ambitious build to date and put the members of the team to the test. Let's meet the team. Craig Sutton is the founder of FishingNosara and is the leader of the FishingNosara Build Team. Craig has a lifetime of fishing experience, and he brings that to bear in his designs when it comes to laying out the perfect sport fishing vessel. Craig's experience is the reason that every FishingNosara boat is custom tailored to the task at hand. Brian Poslett is our chief engineer and master mechanic for the FishingNosara Build Team. He has 30 years experience as an ASC certified master mechanic and is also an expert at carpentry and electrical wiring. Basically, this is the kind of guy you want if anything breaks or if anything needs to be built. Then there's me, your run-of-the-mill computer jockey, artist, painter, parts purchaser, supply runner, sander. I handle most of FishingNosara's online marketing, including the monthly fishing report and the FishingNosara blog. As we expanded our fleet, we also expanded our facilities. When we started the Wanderer, we didn't have anywhere to work on it. We just used a dusty patch behind the shops. Eventually, we moved into a cramped 800-foot warehouse. We built a 30-foot by 40-foot tent to accommodate the Discoverer and used that as our base of operations for the next 2 years. A month after the Discoverer was completed, Hurricane George came and destroyed the tent, leading us to build this new permanent structure for our next project. Over the years, our tactics on boat building have come a long way. When we first got the Wanderer, we had no idea how fiberglass worked. When she sustained damage in Garza Bay, it took two men a full week to fix this small patch. Within the year, we were able to pour large pieces of fiberglass in proficient numbers. Our painting technique has evolved over time as well. The first repaint of the Wanderer was done with paintbrushes by hand. Then during one particularly memorable summer, we tried to repaint the boat using a car paint gun. After much trial and error, we finally discovered the right gun for gel coat and figured out how to mix it properly. All of this trial and error underscores that there's no manual for building a boat. It comes from equal parts patience and curiosity, not to mention relying on experts who've been doing it for years for their advice. The Discover Project afforded us an opportunity to advance our relationship with Florida Sportsman magazine. At the very beginning of FishingNosara, our entire advertising budget could be described as this single 18th of a page ad in the back of one of their issues. The community of anglers in Florida are so passionate about their fishing that their response to this little ad set us on a path to become the best sport fishing operation in Costa Rica. During the Discover Project, we participated in their boat build forum online and provided inspiration for other everyman boat builders to pursue their own dream boat projects. Now, Florida Sportsman is launching a new television series, Project Dreamboat, and it's an honor to receive the invite to appear on an episode this season. The Discover Project devoured 2 years of our lives, and there were days where we felt we were at the breaking point.
About 6 inches. Whoa!
There was a great sense of joy and relief the moment she floated free in Garza Bay. Fresh off the Discover Project, the FishingNosara Build Team is setting on another course to redefine Costa Rica sport fishing. The genesis of the Harvester Project has been the success of our 26-foot Super Panga, the Explorer. The Explorer was a gamble to begin with. We purchased the hull from a company in Nicaragua, sight unseen. We had a custom radar arch designed and built in the United States, then shipped to Costa Rica for final assembly. In late December 2011, we tricked out what would become the baddest panga in the entire Pacific Ocean. Armed with 9 feet of sunshade, 16 rod holders, split consoles with the client console, integrated fish boxes, a live tuna tube, and lots of other sport fishing tricks, the 26-foot barroom brawler beat down the competition, proving that a small panga with a single 75-horse motor could do battle with the biggest fish in the ocean. The secret of the panga hull design is a big bow with a flat rear end. The big nose helps it cut through the waves, and the flat back provides lift, so long as you don't have the boat weighed down with a big heavy motor. As the legend of the Explorer grew, we began to wonder how a panga would operate if it was a full 32-footer like our flagship Wanderer and our newly launched battleship Discoverer. We had to search far and wide to find the best panga hull in the Western Hemisphere, but we found it from Eduardona Boats, based out of Colombia. Though not a household name here in the States, Eduardona Pangas are legendary around the world. Their hulls are true workhorses and are a staple of law enforcement, Coast Guard, and recreational boaters alike. The 32-foot Corvina hull is exactly what we're looking for. Strong, light, and proven to last in rough conditions. This hull has the classic panga shape, but as an added feature, the rear scoops on the middle like a surfboard, creating more lift when you get up on plane. We placed our order with Eduardona and salivated over this one picture for months while Craig began sketching out his designs for the ultimate mega panga. On November 3rd, 2014, she finally arrived at our Jacksonville, Florida shops. We hadn't really thought this part all the way through. Without a proper forklift or winches, we relied on a very brave truck driver to pull forward as we slid the harvester out of her cradle. After a nerve-wracking few hours, we had the boat properly blocked up and, more importantly, sitting level on the ground. We're about to do a lot of carpentry inside this boat, and we want to make sure that everything is level from the beginning. We have just under 12 months to complete this project in time to be on the Project Dreamboat Show. So we were eager to get started laying out the consoles, coolers, and seats. The theme of this project is saving weight. So throughout the boat, we'll be using Coosa wood instead of standard marine plywood. Coosa wood is a synthetic plywood replacement that is composed completely of fiberglass and resin. It's really cool stuff. It's lighter and stronger than wood, sands and shapes easily, and fiberglass sticks to it like Velcro. The only drawback, it costs $300 per sheet. Therefore, we have to be very careful with each measure and each cut to maximize each piece. We may break the bank buying Coosa wood now, but we'll make up for it in fuel savings over time. Here are the consoles and cooler seats made completely out of Coosa wood. In Costa Rica, gasoline is $7 a gallon, so fuel efficiency will always be a top priority. By our calculations, we should achieve more than 3 miles a gallon as long as we can keep the weight down. Unheard of for a boat this size. One of our clients' favorite features on the Explorer is the split console arrangement. Unlike a center console, the split console creates a long walkway down the center of the boat. This is a much better use of interior space, especially when you have four anglers and the captain and mate all working in their own areas. The Explorer wasn't always a dream boat. In fact, we had to do a few modifications to strengthen the hull to stand up to the Costa Rican environment. Early on, we noticed that the hull was sagging and pinching in the middle where the tower attached. We corrected this by fiberglassing a small block of wood between the hull and the consoles. This allows them to share the force between both pieces. For the harvester, we're expanding this concept to all the components and taking it out to its furthest logical extreme. The coolers, consoles, and seats will all mate together with the hull and the stringers below deck. As one solid piece of fiberglass rather than multiple components, this arrangement should be bulletproof for years down the road. It's a time-consuming process with lots of cutting and reshaping to make sure all these pieces line up. Like all FishingNosara boats, the harvester has a long life ahead of her, a long way from a boat shop. It's crucial that we overbuild her now so we don't end up over-repairing it down the line. It's taken 2 months to get all the components built and wrapped in fiberglass. But in the back of our heads, we hear the clock ticking, with 9 months to go until our date with the Project Dreamboat TV show. All right, let's get everybody up to speed on the basic fiberglass process. The Coosa wood cuts and shapes just like regular plywood, and once we have the shapes made, it's time to encapsulate them in multiple layers of fiberglass so they become waterproof and super strong. A good fiberglass pour is all about procedure. We use paint brushes to saturate the fiberglass mat in polyester resin. We always try to cut our fiberglass pieces to fit before we catalyze the resin, so we're not racing the clock with a pair of scissors. Once catalyzed, fiberglass begins to harden at a constant rate, essentially setting you against the clock to finish spreading the resin and finish with the piece. While you can't just use a paintbrush, a lot of professionals use also a plastic-headed roller. This squeezes out the last few air pockets, some that you can't even see with the naked eye. Now every piece has its own demands and tricks that might come into play. For corner pieces, we might hit the corner with a 4-inch wide strip of fiberglass before doing the subsequent layers, just to add a little more strength and to round out the corner. For square pieces, you have to pay special attention on how you run the lap around the narrow edge, because you don't want any cracks or separations between the large flat panes and the narrow edges on the side. Now you'll notice we're trying to get as much of these pieces built outside the boat on sawhorses, where we have lots of access to get to hard to reach corners. Once all the pieces are cut and wrapped in fiberglass, they're ready to be assembled as needed in the hull of the boat. It's important for us to have the big pieces in place, because now we can align the two stringers that will support the floor of the boat. We're going to mate these stringers to the consoles in order to lend strength to both. On this boat, we're doing everything we can to bind it into one solid piece. It's going to be carrying a lot of weight, a lot of anglers, and hopefully a lot of big fish. So everything needs to be super strong and tied together. Securing the floor was an arduous process of fiberglassing. Three layers with an epoxy core at the sandwich means that this stringer system will never develop soft spots. This is one of those procedures you just can't do in one day. All the 90 degree wraps in every corner have to overlap perfectly, or else you'll have water spots and places for water to intrude. But if you grind away at it, little bit at a time, every day, you'll end up with a product you can be proud of. It's always nice to have a cabin on a boat, and this looks like the perfect place for one. Comfort is a must on a charter boat, and all of our 32-foot vessels have private bathrooms. That means we have to build a roof. We started the construction, as always, out of coosa wood. Basic 90-degree joints will make this thing strong enough for anglers to stand on top and throw topwater lures. Just like with the floor stringers, it's going to be a challenge wrapping fiberglass in all these small corners. We start with the big layers of woven rovin, and then work our way up using biaxle and chop strand. The foredeck has to accommodate the mooring bit and the rope pipe. These are both pieces of hardware that will have extreme physical demands placed on them, so we will be epoxy sleeving the holes for maximum strength. Here's how it's done. First, you over-drill the hole by two drill bit sizes. Then, you fill it up with 610 epoxy and let it cure overnight. Then you fiberglass over the plugs. Once you sand that fiberglass down, re-drill the hole to the appropriate size, and you've made a hole that will be bulletproof for decades to come. Once this thing's installed, it's going to be hard to get to it, so we went ahead and gel coated the underside before installation. We're using 610 thickened epoxy to glue the roof onto the cabin. We'll be using this approach throughout the boat in an effort to not use metal hardware. No screws, no bolts, just pure fiberglass, coosa wood, and epoxy will make the harvester our vision of a boat that is truly a single solid piece. We built these small tabs to hold the roof into place while the epoxy cures. The epoxy sets up in 8 hours and takes a full 24 hours to cure. Once it's cured, it has a strength of 2,000 PSI. However, to make sure that we get a perfect bond on this foredeck, we have to figure out how to apply uniform downward pressure over the entire piece. We use 2x6 16-foot long boards and your basic everyday C-clamp in order to spread out the downward force and make sure that all the 610 epoxy filled the crevices between the roof and the hull. In the past, we've used cement blocks or buckets of water or any other heavy object. But since we'll be repeating this procedure on all the floor pieces, we wanted to build a jig that we could reuse over and over. Fortunately, the harvester hull has a curved gunnel lip, so we can use dead wood and clamps to create a firm grip on the sides. After making sure no epoxy squeezed out the bottom, we get started on one of the worst fiberglass jobs on the whole boat. Working in these tight corners should make it clear why we're trying to do so much of the work on sawhorses and not up in the cabin. We repeated the roof installation with a second piece. And once it was epoxied and fiberglassed into place, we could put the finishing touches on flattening out the entire casting platform. We used micro balloons and resin to build up a putty around the edges, then an air file and a lot of time on the DA until it was perfectly flat. Before we move on to install the floor, it's time to install the consoles, the coolers, and the forwards and aft facing seats. In keeping with our one solid piece approach, we epoxy the consoles into place with a continuous bead of epoxy that touches the walls, floor, and stringers. You see here we use a small wedge in order to open up the void and get all the 610 into place. This approach worked magnificently on the edges that were facing in, forwards, and back. However, the outside edge prevented quite a different challenge. We could barely fit the camera into this little crack, so imagine how much fun it was pouring three layers of fiberglass, using paintbrushes with a drumstick taped to the end. However, the end result is spectacular. These consoles are a sturdy brick of fiberglass. With all the major components in place, we can now move ahead to fabricating the floor. We build the precise angles based on the location of the consoles and the coolers. Then we wrap everything in fiberglass, but to make the floor smooth, we top it with a layer of red micro balloons. This gives us something to sand nice and flat. Once polished, this creates a great surface for adding gel coat later. The best way to make sure you get flat results with your finished product is to make sure it's flat throughout the process. We move it into position and make some minor cuts to make sure it'll drop into place. The better flush that the floor piece is to the consoles and seats and the hull sides, the less we have to backfill with extra epoxy. Just like the floor stringers and the major components, the floor itself will serve to stiffen and strengthen the harvester. Then we brush away all the loose dust and acetone all the mating surfaces. Once clean, the 610 epoxy should set up a perfect bead to accept the upcoming floor. We modified our jig press to include a couple of bottle jacks. This way the pressure can reach all the way from the gunnel to the floor. Now that all the major pieces are in place, it's time to attend to small details. Brian's built these steps up to the casting platform that also double as rod holders. Craig's putting tons of hours into these custom-made hatches, also completely out of coosa wood. It's tempting to use a store-bought version of a hatch here, but this gives us the custom look and the long-term durability we're looking for. In Garza Bay, we don't have a proper marina facility, so we have to refuel our boats by hand. This process is very manpower intensive and a real pain in the butt, so we don't want to have to refuel the harvester every trip. But on the harvester, we're going to install a fixed fuel tank under the decks. We'll need to cut out one of the stringers to make room for the 70-gallon fuel tank. Fortunately, the guys at Eduardonia had drawn up for us a plan on how to do this without sacrificing the strength of the boat. We finished off the fuel system with this slick filler neck cutout on the port side console. In the course of less than 4 months, the FishingNosara Build Team turned a raw hull into an actual boat. Now it's time to make it look like one.
The sun comes up and the sun goes down. Work away, work away. We'll clear that acre, stake that claim, gather up the timber, tie that chain. Cut that line, sand that plane, sing a little song and do it all again. The sun comes up and the sun goes down. Work away, work away. We'll haul that lumber, lift that frame, grab a little shot and do it all again. The sun comes up and the sun goes down. Work away, work away.
Now, before we get too far ahead of ourselves painting, we have to clean up the mess we've made. We ran a couple hundred gallons of water through the bilge to blow out 5 months worth of construction dust. Clearly, this will save us a couple of bilge pumps once we fire this boat up. The cleanup process continued as we got the boat taped off and wrapped in butcher paper. We sanded everything as many times as we could, and then when we were done, we came back and sanded some more. Gel coat only adheres well to a smooth, flat surface, and any missed spots in sanding will show up in the paint job. Notice also we've taped off our floor lines. We like painting the sides gray to keep the sun under control. Last thing we want is clients out there cooking like a potato chip for 8 hours. We put down 3 good thick coats of white all over the floor and the console pieces. Of course, we remembered our beloved custom hatches as well. We got the first coat down in August, 2 months away from our date with the Florida Sportsman Project Dreamboat Show. Time is starting to get tight, but we have already come a long way. The response to the Harvester Project on the Florida Sportsman forums has been very enthusiastic. Most people are cheering for us. Some can't believe we're actually doing this. Others think we're just downright crazy to take a panga boat and build it up like a 32-foot battle wagon. But the most common question is, why don't you guys just buy a new boat? The fact is, they don't make boats like this one. Every fishery is different, and ours in Costa Rica requires bulletproof hardware. We can't have any downtime or lost trips due to water intrusion or fiberglass delamination or failure of any kind. It's just not an option. Still, we know the real test will be when we get on the air in front of millions of viewers to show that three guys with hand tools can compete with major professional boat shops. Our date with destiny is set for October 22nd, 2 months from now. There is one way that the TV business is different from the boat building business, and that's scheduling. They are not kidding when they say this thing has to be done on a certain date. The cameraman's been hired, the drone has been rented, and Dave East, Florida Sportsman editor, has already planned a trip up to Jacksonville to take her for a test drive. It's our goal to get this thing done a few weeks ahead of time so we can really shake it down. Right now, we're barely on schedule, and we're putting a lot of faith in our friend Troy over at Custom Marine that he can get the tower and bow rail built on time. Any delay at this point, even a couple days, would be disastrous. We're going to have to leave the harvester at Custom Marine Shops for a few weeks. It gives us time to get prepared for a whirlwind rigging process, but it sure feels weird to know that our boat is out of our hands. And time is of the essence. Custom Marine is one of the most prestigious and in-demand marine metal shops in all of Florida. I would put these guys' work up against any of the big shops in South Florida. Troy's a real master when it comes to designing and laying out custom projects. Him and Craig spent several hours going over every minute detail. Length, height, where to anchor it to the gunwale, how the rod holders will lay out, how the steps up to the cabin will work. Every little detail was sweated over. Then, Troy and the boys got down to what they do best. Absolutely stunning. Troy's work, along with the team at Custom Marine, is really something to behold. The rake of the metal just makes the boat look like it's going fast sitting on the trailer. The angles of the rod holders are perfect for our style of fishing. And the fit and finish of everything, from the top to the feet to every bolt, nut, washer, is really an inspiration to us as we move forward on the rigging. When you got a boat that looks this good, you definitely got to finish it off right. It's October 8th. We have exactly 2 weeks to rig the harvester and get her ready for her appearance on the Project Dreamboat TV show. As a charter boat, angler comfort is essential, and these overstuffed seats should do the trick. We squeezed 4-inch foam into a 3-inch opening to give these cushions a real overstuffed feel. The harvester also features twin coolers hidden underneath these seats. Our friends at Taco Metals sent us a rub rail kit. For our boats, knocking around Garza Bay can be a real problem, so we need the strongest flexible vinyl rub rail they make. We've installed a lot of these before, and they always go on smoothly. They also set us up with their Top Gun outrigger system and a deluxe rigging kit. These will pair perfectly with our outrigger reels. Meanwhile, Brian is working at a breakneck pace to complete the captain's console. The console face is built out of black Lexan and features a C-Star helm. Underneath the console, a simple wiring system will be easy to maintain once the boat's in Costa Rica, while still maintaining all the features you'd expect from a top-end sport fishing boat. For durability, we use point-to-point wiring and glass fuses. The console has a clean, old-school vibe, all the way down to the dial-style gauges. Before we finish the wiring, we have to get the fuel tank in place. Two bilge pumps, two live well pumps, the motor wiring harness, running lights, and accessories. This is a huge amount of work to get done, especially in such a tight window. FishingNosara is on our 10th year of exclusively using Yamaha outboards for power. We're especially excited to try out the new 200 horse. It's the same block used on our ultra-reliable 31-foot T-crafts, overboard and overpowered to create a little extra oomph. For the radio box, we skipped the cheap plastic junk you can buy at the store and built our own from Coosa Wood and Lexan. The captain goes in and out of this cubbyhole dozens of times per trip, and the store-bought junk just can't take the abuse. Our friends at Gemlux provided the friction hinges for these hatches. The friction hinge means that you don't need a slam to keep it shut. Less hardware means less chance of hardware problems. They also hooked us up with these boltless rod holders, so the baits in the tuna tube and live well are always a quick pitch away. It's October 21st, and after 342 days of work, there is one day left to get the harvester ready for the water and for the air. All hands are on deck as it's crunch time on the harvester project. The windshields have been attached to the consoles. This iconic design is a direct tribute to the Explorer. All the cushions are in place. The step-ups to the cabin are complete. The cabin door and cabin hatch are in place. And we're shining her up to get ready for the TV cameras. The fuel filler's been installed, and 70 gallons of gas are down in the tank waiting for us to turn the key. Of course, no boat's really done until the Coast Guard says it is, so we got our life jackets and fire extinguisher ready too. The wiring compartment's been tidied up, and the radio box has been installed with its ICOM shortwave radio and an AM/FM to pumps and tunes. With only hours to spare, we took delivery of the harvester's secret weapon. This Release Marine battle saddle performs all the tasks of a fighting chair at a fraction of the footprint. As the sun set on the final day of the harvester project, Craig took one last look around for any last second things we might have missed. It's been a long haul, but we're ready to get in this chair, turn the key, and fire it up.
Me awake and hit me with a hand of broken nail. You tied my lead and pulled my chain to watch my blood begin to boil. But I'm gonna break, I'm gonna break my, gonna break my rusty cage and run. I'm gonna break, I'm gonna break my, gonna break my rusty cage and run. Too cold to start a fire, I'm burning diesel, burning dinosaur bones. I'll take the river down to still water and ride a pack of dogs. I'm gonna break, I'm gonna break my, gonna break my rusty cage and run. I'm gonna break, I'm gonna break my, gonna break my rusty cage and run. Burns along the road like God's eyes in my headlights. When the dogs are looking for their bones and it's raining ice picks on your steel shore. I'm gonna break, I'm gonna break my, I'm gonna break my rusty cage and run. I'm gonna break my, gonna break my rusty cage and run. I'm gonna break, I'm gonna break my, gonna break my rusty cage and run. I'm gonna break, I'm gonna break my, gonna break my rusty cage.
Welcome back to Florida Sportsman Project Dreamboat. Join us during this one man's dream boat ride along, where we feature boats and their owners whose dreams have already become reality. FS Boating editor Dave East meets with Craig Sutton to discuss the build of his custom-built Panga, headed to explore blue water in Costa Rica.
This is an Eduardonia 32 Corvina. We decided the Panga is the really, truly best boat that suits us. And this boat is a culmination of all the things that we wanted to put in one boat to make this boat the perfect Costa Rica big game fighting machine. Because what we fish for in Costa Rica, big giant marlin, giant yellowfin, big super big cabarrus, it requires a special piece of equipment to do that on a day-to-day basis. Not only the tackle, but the boat too. This boat, when we purchased it from Eduardonia, it was a shell, a bare shell. It had the horizontal hoops and the lateral stringers. That was it. We built everything you see here has been built out of coosa wood. Super light, super strong, but it sheds water. So if we do get a penetration, a crack in the fiberglass, for the 9 months the boat's sitting on anchor, we don't have to worry about getting out of the water and sealing it up. The water penetration won't delaminate the fiberglass. Plus, the overall boat is about 60% lighter when we finish the product, and it's much stronger, too. The reason we like the dual consoles over a center console is these are charter boats. We want to make sure everybody feels part of it, and with the openness, the center part being open on a split console, the person can be in the front of the boat, watch the baits, watch the person fighting the fish, and feel like they're part of it. Plus, the sun's super intense in Costa Rica. We need a lot of sunshade. And these split consoles with the sunshade from side to side and from the front of the console's back gives you the maximum amount of sunshade. We do a tremendous amount of topwater castings. Cabin in the front that you could climb onto and be comfortable while you're topwater casting. Then we also got this area here. If it's a little bit rough, the client can stand in front of the consoles and still cast and not, you know, hook into somebody else. We fight all our billfish off the back of the boat. We don't run them down kingfish like we do in Florida. we're fighting billfish, so we actually will quarter the fish and keep them off the back and then release it out the back of it. This is a fighting gimbal, and this thing can be used several different ways depending on the angler's height. If the person's real tall, they sit on it like a conventional fighting chair. If they're not a medium or a smaller height, they stand behind it, put the rod in the gimbal, and then fight it that way. It's just like a fighting chair, and the fish that we pursue down there, we want the angler to be as comfortable as possible and exert as least amount of energy. We like to release the fish healthy, get the angler where they're in and out of the fighting the fish in 20 minutes where they don't get wore out, and everybody's comfortable, and we go back and fish for another one. One of the things our boats have to have is they have to have a big mooring cleat on the front. That mooring bit on the front is about as big as we can get because our boats are moored up at 9.5, 10 months out of the year. They're in a bay. Sometimes when the storms come through, the waves get trapped and they start bouncing around the bay and they start coming from all directions and the boat won't be able to compensate. So it's very important, it's very strong in the mooring bit. The gas mileage is very, very critical. In these Panga boats, they get super good gas mileage. Our gas in Costa Rica is not only it's $8 a gallon, but it takes us a half a day, one man, to go get the gas and then put it in the boats. There's no marina where we're at. So what we do down there, it's all about function, very little form. They have to be pretty much bulletproof. Our boats run 150 to 290 plus trips a year. They're fishing almost every single day.
There must be lights burning brighter somewhere. Got to be birds flying higher in a sky more blue. If I can dream of a better land where all my brothers walk hand in hand, tell me why, oh why, oh why can't my dream come true? Oh why? There must be peace and understanding sometime, strong winds of promise that will blow away all the doubt and fear. If I can dream of a warmer sun where hope keeps shining on everyone, tell me why, oh why, oh why won't that sun
The harvester was completed in November 2015 and after a 2-month shakedown was delivered to Garza on January 17, 2016. let's take a look around the boat and see some of the features that make her so special. Starting with propulsion, you can't beat a Yamaha when it comes to reliability and durability. This 200 horse outboard gives us all the power we need to get up on plane while still conserving fuel and keeping our costs manageable. Like all our 32-foot boats, the Harvester features a private bathroom and a private cabin for anglers desiring the utmost privacy and comfort on the water. The Harvester features this broad-nose casting platform and observation deck, perfect for taking in the sights or for trying your hand at fly fishing. The captain is given all the tools he needs to put you on the fish and bring home the big one. Onboard GPS and compass keep our bearings, and this Hummingbird XD fish finder is specially designed to read the extreme depths where we find our best fish. An offshore ICOM radio keeps us in touch with the other boats on the team and the office on shore. U.S. Coast Guard safety equipment and life jackets are provided for all anglers, and we carry plenty of ice and water for every trip. In addition to the essentials, every trip includes fruit, water, snacks, and lunch if over 5 hours. When it comes to fishing tools, the Harvester is fully armed, rigged for inshore jigging, offshore trolling, and topwater casting. We keep a full arsenal of Shimano Tiagra offshore reels and Pen 760 slammers for inshore use. This custom-built Release Marine fighting gimbal provides all the benefits of a fighting chair with a fraction of the footprint. We also maintain a large supply of professional quality tackle, teasers, lures, and hooks. The coolers and fish boxes are integrated into the seat design, maximizing the use of available space in the cockpit. The live well is also integrated to the hull for easy access and maximum space savings. A pair of live tuna tubes provide the extra edge of using live bait while bottom fishing or for pitching a fresh treat to a hard-charging billfish. The Harvester hit the ground running upon her launch with 7 sailfish released on her first day of fishing. She's run upwards of 20 trips a month since then, with all clients reporting big fish and big smiles.
My car. I got pictures, candy, I'm a lovable man. Try to sound that boat, Maurice.
Put it in and then do the back beat with a kick in the air.
Right.
On its nose.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I was thinking it might be one of the electrical, it might be closer.